Hello guys, a very good morning to all of you. I hope that you are all doing well. So in this session, I have brought to you the international as well as banking and economy section of Spotlight. So quickly, we will be discussing all the relevant news from the international section as well as from the banking and economy section. But before that, I would like to tell you to subscribe to our channel and hit the bell notification to get all the latest updates. And do not forget to subscribe to our Telegram channel as well. So quickly discuss the international section. So I will be taking up the questions first, and through questions we will be discussing the news in very brief manner because we have to discuss banking and economy section as well. So, for what is our first question? The first question is, which country has proposed the Supply Chain Resilience Initiative? So, what is the news all about? The news is that Japan has proposed to create this initiative with India and Australia to strengthen the supply chain and reduce dependence on one country for export and import of goods. Now, in the present scenario, the majority of export and import is dependent on one country, on China, which is the major exporter of this world. So due to the COVID disruptions, the entire supply chain has been dismantled in 2020. And in order to avoid such a situation from arising again, Japan has proposed to start this initiative. Do remember this thing, that it is still in the stage of proposal. It has not been established. And now let's discuss the answer of this question. So which country has proposed? It is Japan. I hope that it is clear to you. Now next question is, which of the following is not a parameter of the Times World University Ranking 2021? So guys, if you remember that I always tell my students that if you are covering any kind of ranking, you have to keep 5 points in your mind. First point is the organization releasing that index or the ranking, then the top university or the top country, then the parameters, then we have India's rank, and then we have the total number of countries or the universities that are being ranked in that particular index or ranking. So in this Times World University ranking, we have a question from the parameters. So now let's discuss the index in detail quickly, and then we will be discussing the answer of this question. So it has been released by Times Higher Education, total 3 universities from 93 countries. And top university is University of Oxford from UK. From India, Indian Institute of Science Bangalore is the top university, which is globally ranked in the range of 301 to 350. So globally, India is so backward, and that the highest ranked Indian university is in the range of 300 to 350. So that is a shame on Indian higher education sector, that and alert for that sector as well, that now we need to wake up and we need to promote the innovation and research in our higher education to increase the ranking of India in different kind of indexes. Then the next is IIT Roorkee, which was in the 301 to 350 bracket last year, and it is now in 351 to 400 rank. So these are the top two highest ranked Indian institutes. Now let's discuss the parameters. So first is teaching, then research, citation, industry income, and international outlook. So these are the 5 parameters on which various institutes or universities were assessed. And now discuss the answer of this question. So clearly the answer is faculties expertise, which is not a parameter of this ranking. I hope that it is clear to you, and in case you have any kind of doubt or suggestion, you can ask me or mention it in the comment section below. Next is again about the index. What is India's rank in the Global Innovation Index 2020? So quickly, let's go through the index. World Intellectual Property Organization, in collaboration with Cornell S.C. Johnson College of Business and INSEAD, released this 13th edition of Global Innovation Index 2020. Title of the report is, Who Will Finance Innovation? Not very important for you to remember, it is just for your reference. Total number of countries, 131. Top country, Switzerland. India's rank, 48. Now this is 4 places up, 4 places improvement from 2019. Rank. And this is the first time that India has ranked in the top 50. So quite a pride moment for India that it has now ranked at 48th position in the top 50. Top Asian countries, Singapore at 8th rank. Then we have Republic of Korea at 10th rank. Now, what are the parameters of these rankings? Total 80 indicators, which were divided into two categories, input and output. You don't need to remember 80 indicators, just remember the number. The total number of indicators were 80, categorized into two categories, input and output. And the new indicator, which was introduced in 2020. So the new indicator is brand value. And on this brand value indicator, India has ranked 31st. I hope that it is clear to you, and now let's discuss the India's rank in the index. So India's rank is 48, as I have told you that India is in the top 50. Now this is our next question. Who is the president and CEO of US India Strategic Partnership Forum? First, we need to know about this forum. This was set up in 2017 to promote India and US partnership. And in its meeting, this US ISPF has appointed its new president and CEO. And who is this new president and CEO? It is Dr. Mukesh Aghi. Option D. Which company has named its commercial cargo space craft as SS Kalpana Chawla in honor of Chawla, who is the first India-born woman to enter space? So in order to honor Kalpana Chawla, the company, which is named as Northrop Grumman, has named its spacecraft after Kalpana Chawla. Do remember this thing, and there is nothing else to discuss about this news. We have, what is India's rank in the Global Economic Freedom Index? Again, a lot of indices that we have in this international news section. So do pay attention to this section. Economic Freedom of the World 2020 Annual Report. So this report has Economic Freedom Index as well. It is released by Canada's Fraser Institute. Do remember the organization as well. Now, the total number of countries, 162. Top country is Hong Kong, followed by Singapore at second place. Then we have India's rank at 105th, which is down by 26 points from its position in 2019. So, in 2019, India was 79th, and now India has been ranked at 105th position. So, next is our bottom country, Venezuela. How many parameters were there? Total 5 parameters. Size of government, legal system and property rights, sound money, freedom to trade internationally and regulation. So these were the 5 parameters of the index. Now let's discuss the question. So what is India's rank? It is 105th. Do remember this thing that India is 26 places down. So this is very important. Now next is WHO's new report, Countdown to 2023, WHO report on global transfer elimination 2020. So this is very important because trans fat consumption is quite dangerous for our health, and therefore WHO has prescribed a limit of consuming trans fats in our daily food intake. So what is that limit? The limit is less than 1%. The question is, what is the trans fat level of total energy intake prescribed by WHO? It is less than 1%. Now comes our next question, which is about Human Capital Index 2020. Quite important. Do listen to me very carefully. World Bank releases it. Title is Human Capital in the Times of COVID-19. Quite easy to remember. Total 174 countries. India's rank is 116. And last year India was ranked at 115 out of 157 countries. Now the total number of countries has also been increased. So there is an anomaly in comparing the last ranking and the latest ranking of India. Then we have parameters. So health and education of children are divided into 5 indicators of child survival, school enrollment, quality of learning, healthy growth, and adult survival. So these are the 5 categories under which the child health and education parameters of children are divided. Now what is India's rank in this index? It is 116. I hope it is clear to you, and if it is not, then do mention it in the comment section. I will reply to you in the comment section itself. Now next comes our question, which is about which Indian city is the highest ranked in Global Smart Cities Index 2020. Again, an important index that we are going to discuss. IMD has released it in collaboration with Singapore University for Technology and Design, and this is the second edition. Total 109, top 3, Singapore, Helsinki, which is in Finland, Zurich in Switzerland. Indian cities rank. So in this index, the Indian cities, the 4 major Indian cities have faced a downturn in their ranking. So what is their rank? Let's discuss that. So Hyderabad is the top ranked Indian city in this Global Smart Cities Index, and it is ranked at 85th position. In 2019, Hyderabad's rank was 67. So it is a very drastic downturn that Hyderabad has taken in this index. Then New Delhi at 86th rank. Mumbai is at 93rd rank, Bangalore is at 95th rank. What are the parameters of this index? Health and safety, mobility, activities, opportunities, and governance. Now let's discuss the answer. So which city is the highest ranked city in the Global Smart Cities Index? Quite easy. Hyderabad, we have just discussed it. Next is the question. So which has become the first country in the world to issue a sovereign sustainable development goal bond? Now from the name itself, it is very very obvious. The purpose of this bond is very obvious. That is to fund the projects which are helpful in fulfilling sustainable development goals. So which country is the very first country in this world to issue the SDG bonds? It is Mexico. Which country has unveiled 3 first of its kind concept zero emission commercial aircraft codenamed as Zero E? So 3 aircrafts which are the concept zero emission commercial aircrafts. Basically these Zero E aircrafts will run on hydrogen gas, and that is why they are very clean. They are fueled on a clean energy source. And which one company has done that? It is Airbus SE, which is a French company. I hope it is clear to you and you will remember it for your examination. Next is, which country will co-host the UN Global Climate Summit 2020? So which country it is? It is Britain, UK, with UN. So both the UK and UN will host this UN Global Climate Summit 2020 that will be held at the end of this year. Now we have another thing of importance, is that is UN Climate Change Conference COP26 will be held in Glasgow, UK in 2021. Quite important for us to remember. Next question is about which has become the world's first country to make climate risk reporting mandatory for banks, asset managers and insurance. Quite easy. And what is the answer? It is New Zealand. Then we have the ministerial roundtable. So which country hosted the recently concluded ministerial online roundtable Biodiversity Beyond 2020? Building a shared future for all life on earth. We have covered it in Morning Tales in detail, so I hope that you remember the answer of this question. So the answer is China. China has organized this ministerial round table. Now let's quickly have a glance over the other facts that are mentioned here. So United Nations Summit on Biodiversity will be held in September 2020 in New York. New York is the headquarters of UN under the theme Urgent Action in Biodiversity for Sustainable Development. 2011 to 2020 is the UN Decade on Biodiversity. 15th COP of Convention on Biological Diversity will be held in Kunming in China in 2021. I hope you remember these facts. I have mentioned these facts in Morning Tale series. So I hope that my students already know the answers of those questions. Which organization has released the World Risk Index 2020? Now this risk index has been covered in PIB 24/7 in quite a great detail. And now let's discuss the answer of this question. So which organization has released it? It is UN University Institute for Environment and Human Security, which has released this index. Let's have a glance over the facts of this index. Total countries 181. Top three countries which are at the most risk of climate change, which is Vanuatu, which is in South Pacific region. Then we have Tonga in South Pacific region, Dominica in Caribbean region. So these three countries are at the most risk of climate change. Then we have most risked continent. Which continent is the most vulnerable, is the most susceptible to climate change or the disasters, the natural disasters? So it is Oceania, followed by Africa and America. What is India's rank? 89th overall and fourth most risk country in South Asia. Next is, which country has received the world's first shipment of blue ammonia for generating electricity? Again, we have discussed it in Morning Tales. I hope that you have remembered the answer. So it is Japan. How many Indian institutes have been ranked in top 100 of Financial Times Masters in Management 2020 rankings? Again, discussed in Morning Tales. So how many Indian institutes have been ranked here? Do tell me your answers in the comment section. Okay, so let's discuss about this index a little bit. So this index ranks the B schools. B schools are management schools. Top institutes, total number of institutes, 100. Top is University of St. Gallen, Switzerland. All Indian institutes, total number of 5. Top is IIM Ahmedabad at 20th rank, IIM Calcutta at 21st rank, SP Jain at 36th, along with IIM Bangalore and IIM Udaipur at 72nd rank. What are the parameters? Total 23 parameters on which the universities were ranked. I hope that you remember all these facts, because these facts have already been discussed by me in Morning Tales. And now comes our next session, section of flashcard, which is banking and economy, and international section has ended. So in this banking and economy, the first question is, How much interest rate is earned on sovereign gold bond scheme? Let's first discuss what this gold bond scheme is, and then we will be discussing about the interest rate. So Indian government had launched this scheme in 2015 to curb the import of gold in India, and the sixth and last tranche, or the sixth and last tranche of sovereign gold bonds for 2020-2021 will be open for subscription for 5 days till September 4th. This is not important for us to remember. This is just to tell you that why this sovereign gold bond scheme is in news. When it was launched in 2015, it is that old. So why is it in news? Because the last tranche of it has been open. So it was open on September, or open till September 4th. What is the function of sovereign gold bond? Under this scheme, RBI issues bonds linked to the market value of gold on behalf of Government of India, so that people who want to invest in gold can buy these bonds instead of physical gold. Quite easy to understand what is the purpose of sovereign gold bond scheme and how will it curb the import of gold. So I think that it is now clear to you. Now, what is the tenure of gold bonds? For how many years can you purchase or can you keep the gold bonds? It is 8 years. Exit option is allowed after 5 years. If you want to exit or sell your gold bonds, you can do so after 5 years, 5 years of lock-in period. Their interest rate is 2.5% per annum. So the answer is option C, 2.5% per annum. Then which agency is the selling agency of these bonds? Obviously, these are government bonds. They cannot be sold by any trader or any kind of exchange. There are certain authorized exchanges or agencies which sell these bonds. So which agencies are those? It is BSE and NSE authorized stock exchanges, and the Stock Holding Corporation and the branches of India Post. So these are the organizations which can sell these bonds. That was all about the first news. I hope that it is clear to you. If you have any kinds of doubts about sovereign gold bond scheme, do mention it in the comment section below. Which company has launched Lego, an AI-powered voice chatbot on Google Assistant to serve its customers better? So which company is it? It is ICICI Prudential Life Insurance Company. Now there is nothing much to discuss about this news. You can easily remember that ICICI has launched this Lego chatbot to help its customers better, to serve its customers better. As per the ranking released by renewable energy consultancy Marcom Capital Group, Adani is the world's top solar power developer. Quite important statement it is. There are high chances that it can be asked in the examination. And what is the type of question that is asked from this news? Which company is the world's top solar power developer as per the ranking of Mercom Capital Group? So it is Adani. I hope it is clear to you guys. And in this picture, the top 10 global large-scale solar PV developers have been mentioned. And on the top of it, we have Adani Green Energy. Next news is very important. It is about IRDAI's 6-member working group that has been formed to study the feasibility and need of index-linked insurance products in India. So who heads this group? It is Dinesh Pant. Next is, which country will become the first in the world to develop a full set of forensic accounting and investigation standards? So it will be India. Next news is about KV Kamat panel. Now KV Kamat panel was formed in the month of August 2020 when RBI released its monetary policy. So under that policy, the KV Kamath panel was formed in order to provide a framework for resolution of stressed assets. So, or for the debt restructuring. So this panel has submitted its report, and in this report, the panel has suggested 5 financial ratios, which are these: total outside liabilities divided by adjusted tangible net worth, total debt by EBITDA, then we have current assets by current liabilities, debt service coverage ratio, and debt average debt coverage ratio. So these are the 5 ratios which the banks will have to consider as a threshold for restructuring the debt of its borrowers. That is one thing that has been suggested by the panel. And the second thing is that the panel has provided the restructuring framework for 26 sectors. And out of these 26 sectors, a great relief has been provided to the housing sector, the realty sector. So the EBITDA for residential real estates is 9 or less than that. And for commercial real estates, it is 12 or less than that. And the question is about the EBITDA ratio suggested by Kamath panel for residential real estate sector. So what is the answer? It is 9. I hope that it is clear to you. If it is not clear, then do watch the RBI 247 section, because 247 session, because in that session Mansi ma'am has covered this news in quite a depth, in quite a great depth, and you can easily understand what these ratios are and what is the applicability of these ratios. Then comes our next news, which is about which company has partnered with Transnet Port Terminals in South Africa to digitalize the logistics market place in South Africa. So which country it is? Tata Consultancy Services. The purpose is clearly mentioned in the question itself, and we will be moving ahead with our next question. So how many payment banks operate in India at present? So recently RBI has cancelled the license of Aditya Birla Idea Payments Bank. So after this payment bank has ceased to be a payments bank, there are only 5 operational payments bank in India. Do remember this thing. And which 5 payment banks are these? Are Airtel, India Post, Fino, Jio, and Paytm. So these are the 5 payments banks which are operational at present in India. Who heads the government panel formed to study the impact of waiving off the interest on loans during the moratorium period offered by COVID hit borrowers that ended August 31st? Quite important, very important, I would say. Do listen to me very carefully. Ministry of Finance has formed this panel, which is headed by Rajiv Maharishi, to study the impact of waiving of the interest on loans during the moratorium period. So this is very important, and the answer is Rajiv Maharishi. So do remember this thing. And I hope the purpose is quite clear, to study the impact of waiving of interest on loan moratorium loans. Basically the loans which were there in loan moratorium. Okay, so next question is, what is the minimum fixed tenure of chief compliance officer in banks as prescribed by RBI? So this is the new guidelines that RBI has provided for the appointment of CCOs. And as part of these guidelines, the minimum fixed tenure has been prescribed for CCOs, and that period is 3 years. Then comes our next news. MasterCard has launched central bank digital currencies testing platform to help central banks in evaluating their digital currencies. Quite important as well as easy to understand. So this platform will help central banks of different countries to assess the feasibility or the viability of digital currencies like Bitcoin or the cryptocurrency. That is quite a news nowadays. Next is about which bank has launched iStartup 2.0 initiative to help startups in regulatory assistance, analytics, staffing, etc. etc. So, iStartup has been launched by ICICI Bank. How can you remember it better? You can remember it better from the I. iStartup and ICICI Bank both start with I. So, I is common. So, you can easily deploy this trick to remember that iStartup 2.0 was launched by ICICI Bank. Then we have EASE 2.0. Reform Agenda Ranking. So, Ministry of Finance has released this EASE 2.0 Reform Agenda Ranking. Now, guys, let me apprise you with the fact that EASE 2.0 is very important, because in about phase 2 examination, a total number of 4 questions were there from EASE ranking itself. So do pay attention to this EASE ranking framework. So EASE ranking system was launched in the year 2018 for institutionalizing clean and smart banking. Reform is for what? For bringing transparency, from bringing the reforms in the existing structure to make it better. So that is why this EASE reform agenda was launched in 2018. Overall score of PSBs in EASE 2.0 is increased by 37% between March 2019 to 2020. So the score is now 67.4%. These are just the facts. You need to mug up these facts anyhow, because they are important and it can be asked in the examination. Now, the highest improvement was seen in the responsible banking, governance and HR PSBs as Udyam Mitra for MSMEs and credit offtake parameters. So these are certain parameters on which banks have performed very well. So that is why this fact is mentioned here. Next is this picture, which is very important. So you can clearly see that the top three banks on EASE 2.0 index are Bank of Baroda, State Bank of India and Oriental Bank of Commerce. Now we have top three banks on each of the themes. So there are total 6 themes or 6 parameters, like responsible banking, customer responsiveness and credit offtake, etc. And out of these three, and out of these 6 themes, we have been given 3 top bankers, top public sector banks. So this picture is quite important for you to remember. This picture is provided in Spotlight magazine as well as in Flashcard itself. You can see here. So now let's discuss the question. So what is the type of question that is asked here? Which bank has topped in the EASE 2.0 reform agenda ranking? Now guys, do pay attention to this, that no individual theme is mentioned here. So that means that this question is asking about the bank which has topped in the overall categories, in the overall ranking. So which bank it is, do you remember? We have just discussed it. It's Bank of Baroda. Next is, which company has signed a 15 million debt agreement with ADB to help sustain poultry farming operations as well as rural livelihood and food security missions in India? So it is Suguna Food. Nothing to discuss much, just a factual question. Next is, what is the percentage of minimum total assets that multi-cap mutual funds are required to invest in equities of large, mid and small cap companies? So recently SEBI has released the guidelines for multi-cap funds, mutual funds, and SEBI has mandated these funds to invest 75% of their investment of their portfolio in equities of large, mid and small caps. So this 75% is equally divided into 25% each in large, mid and small cap companies. So what is the answer of this question? It is 75%. I hope it is well, it is clear to you, and do remember this thing that this news is covered in RBI 247 session in quite detail. Not only this news, but the other topics which are related to this news have been covered in quite depth in RBI 247. So do watch the sessions of RBI 247 as well. Then we have International Financial Services Center Authority has signed an MOU with India Gold Policy Center to get guidelines for establishing the International Bullion Exchange at IFSCA, in which IIM is the India Gold Policy Center located. So first of all, let's bifurcate the question, let's simplify the question, and then we will reach on the answer. So what is the question saying? The question is saying that IFSCA, that is International Financial Services Center Authority, has signed an MOU with India Gold Policy Center. What is the purpose of MOU? To set up the International Bullion Exchange at IFSCA. What is bullion? Bullion is the gold and precious metals. So the exchange would be trading in gold and other precious metals. So in order to set up this International Bullion Exchange at IFCA, this center and this center have collaborated. Now, in which IIM is this India Gold Policy Center located? It is located in IIM Ahmedabad. Option E is our right answer. I hope that the news is clear to you. If you have any kinds of doubt, you can read out from here in the news section, and still the doubt prevails, then you can ask me in the comment section or on the Telegram channel. Then we have the next question. RBI has proposed to allow foreign portfolio investors to undertake exchange traded rupee interest rate derivatives transactions for a maximum of dash crore. So what is the threshold amount? It is rupees 5000 crores. Do remember this thing that again this has been covered in RBI 24/7, which is the finance current affairs session. So this is covered in detail there, you can watch it from there. Then we have Karnataka Vikas Gramin Bank, which has launched this Vikas Laghu Swarn scheme. So what is this Vikas Laghu Swarn scheme? It is to promote lending by pledging gold. So which bank it is? Karnataka Vikas Gramin Bank. Then we have the question about the chairperson of company law committee. Now you would be thinking that it is an appointment question. So what is it doing here in the banking and economy section? So let's first discuss the news so that you will get your answers automatically. So the news is Ministry of Corporate Affairs. Who is the minister of this ministry? Nirmala Sitharaman. So she has extended the tenure of company law committee by 1 year till September 2021. And the ministry has also appointed a new chairman to this committee. So who is the new chairman? It is Rajesh Verma. Earlier the chairman was NJP Srinivasan. Now it is Rajesh Verma, who is also the corporate affairs secretary. I hope the news is clear to you. Then we have, with which company has iFund Women partnered to launch a grant program in India to boost female entrepreneurship? Quite important and easy factual question that we have. So it is Visa. Visa and iFund Women have partnered to boost Indian female entrepreneurship. Then SBI has launched this Mahila Aatmanirbhar Shil Achhan Women Self-Reliance Program in Assam to provide funding to women self-help groups. Quite easy for us to remember, and the answer is being automatically given here. Next question is about which bank has launched the new vertical emerging entrepreneurs business to help the entrepreneurs who have little or no access to banking facilities. So which bank has launched this new emerging entrepreneur business vertical? So it is Bandhan Bank. Quite a factual question. You need to remember the vertical as well as the bank. Now we have another layer to this news, and that additional layer is the executive president and head of this EEB vertical. So who is the head? This Kumar Ashish. Do remember this thing. And Bandhan Bank MD and CEO is Chandrasekhar Ghosh. Technical group on social stock exchange. Do you remember? We have covered it in Morning Tales. So who heads this SEBI's technical group on social exchange? Harsh Kumar Dhanwa, who is the former NABARD chairman. So do remember these details, guys, that I am providing you in the morning tales sessions, because they are very important. And I would again say that I pick up the news from Spotlight only. So this is a summary of Spotlight, and morning tales sessions are the questions from Spotlight itself. So do pay attention to the sessions and watch Morning Tales regularly. Then we have, what is the new threshold for filing request with SEBI for rights issue? So recently this threshold has been increased to 50 crore. The next question is about Banking Regulation Amendment Bill. So recently this bill has been passed by the Parliament. Which of the following act does the bill aim to amend? So it is to amend the Banking Act 1949. Do remember the year of Banking Regulation Act 1949. So what are the key aspects of this Banking Regulation Amendment Bill? First, it gives power to RBI to control cooperative banks, to control the banking function of cooperative banks. And second is to allow cooperative banks to issue equity shares, preference shares and special shares and unsecured debentures, bonds and other securities with a maturity of 10 or more years to raise funds. So this is the benefit that cooperative banks will get from this bill. I hope that this Smart Act will help you in remembering the functions or in remembering the regulators of cooperative bank. So banking will be regulated by RBI and administrative processes will be regulated by Registrar of Cooperative Societies. Now comes our next question, which is about the technical vision for cyber security for urban cooperative banks 2020 to 2023. We have discussed it in Morning Tales, so we will not be indulging in the details here. We will be quickly discussing the questions. So the question is asking you that in its technology vision document, RBI has suggested a 5-pillar approach guard to strengthen the cyber security of UCBs. What does U stand for in the full form of guard? So U stands for utile. Next is, again discussed in Morning Tales in detail. That's why I will not be discussing it again here in detail, because we have a lot of news to cover in this video only. So I cannot indulge in each and every news that I have already discussed earlier as well. But in case if you have any kind of doubt, don't shy. Just ask me in the comment section below. I will reply to you in the comments there only. And if your doubt is not cannot be described in the comments only, then I will take that doubt in the session. So in tomorrow's session, I will take up your doubt if you have any kinds of doubts. So this question is about IBC Second Amendment Bill 2020. So it empowers government to extend the suspension of fresh insolvency cases for a maximum period of 1 year. Then we have the next question, which is about RBI's positive pay check system. Again discussed in our Morning Tales. So in this question, what is the threshold? What is the answer? It is ₹50,000. Which of the following company has been chosen as the systematically important insurers for 2020 to 2021 by IRDAI? LIC, GIC and New India Assurance Companies. We have discussed this question in the morning tales. Then comes our next question, which is about who heads the three-member committee of directors appointed by RBI of Lakshmi Vilas Bank. So this is very important because recently Lakshmi Vilas Bank is facing quite turmoil in its operations, and therefore RBI has appointed a three-member committee, and the committee is headed by Meeta Makhan. So this committee will handle the operations of Lakshmi Vilas Bank. Now comes our next question, which is about which bank has partnered with Bayer's Better Life Farming Initiative in India to provide financial services to smallholder farmers and ruling farmer communities. So which bank is it? It is Axis Bank, which has partnered with Bayer's Better Life Initiative. Now, what is this Bayer's Better Life Initiative? It was launched in the year 2018 to promote the farming community, to promote livelihood options for farming community. And this Bayer's Better Life Farming Initiative is a global alliance. So it is not restricted to India only. And in order to bring this initiative in India, Axis Bank has partnered with Bayer's Better Life Initiative. Which bank has launched India's first warehouse commodity finance app? We have discussed it in our sessions of morning days. HDFC Bank is the answer. Next comes our question, which is about with which bank has Bombay Stock Exchange signed an MOU to empower SMEs listed on its platform. So it is Yes Bank. Again, we have discussed it in our morning tales session, so do watch morning tales regularly in order to keep a track of things which are going on in India. And here comes our session for the flashcards to an end. I hope that you have liked this session, and do not forget to subscribe to our channel and like this video. Thank you so much.